Hello everybody, this is Jörg Blissmann once again with another reading of Rulers of Evil, Chapter 20, American Graffiti, it is called. I'll start right away here, because this is a very long chapter, probably done in two parts. Let's see how far we get today. Chapter 20, American Graffiti of Rulers of Evil by F. Tupper Saucy. There is a universal legal tradition that requires acts of a governmental authority to be marked by a seal. Otherwise, the acts are not authentic. Typically, a seal discloses the character of the authority it represents by means of an image, which can be, and usually is, amplified by some sentence, phrase, or word. The first seal of the United States of America, designed to authenticate all governmental actions under the Declaration of Independence, was presented to Congress in August 1776. Created by an official committee consisting of Benjamin Franklin, John Adams, and Thomas Jefferson, the seal illustrates an event based on Exodus 14, verses 19 through 27. It is a cameo of Moses leading the Israelites through the parted waters while a chariot-bound Pharaoh, wielding a sword and wearing the crown of tyranny, perishes in the maelstrom. Framing the picture are the words, quote, "Rebellion to tyrants is obedience to God." Unquote. Now, when I first became aware of this seal many years ago, I thought it demonstrated how intensely biblical was the face of the founding fathers. Yeah, how intensely biblical was the face of the founding fathers. But once I began discerning the hidden makers of American naturalism, my thinking changed radically. And I think that is also something my listeners experience while getting through this book. This is exactly what everybody experiences when studying omitted history. When you take a look at many of my videos and also at the website of granddesignexposed.com, where we took a lot of information out of, you can learn of the hidden founding fathers, not only of what Chris Pinto called in his documentary The Hidden Face of the Founding Fathers, but you learn about the hidden founding fathers, as we've learned a lot on the carols, which are the hidden founding fathers here in the book reading, and the religion they hid behind, that is Romanism, as you probably know by now. You will learn, as also in this book pointed out, that the government of the United States of America from the get-go was universal, Catholic, sun-worshipping, Babylonian, Satanism, Luciferianism. The author continues, "I now see this seal, despite the biblical glow of the committee that designed it, as the profession of an intensely Roman Catholic faith. For there is a great disparity between biblical faith and Roman Catholic faith. Indeed, this disparity was the crux of the Protestantism which Pope Paul III commissioned the Society of Jesus to extirpate." Now, I don't want to get too fast over this last paragraph. I hope that you really understood very well what Tupper Saucy wrote here, in absolute truth, what he wrote here. "I now see this seal, despite the biblical glow of the committee that designed it, as the profession of an intensely Roman Catholic faith, for there is a great disparity between biblical faith and Roman Catholic faith, or in other words, there is a great disparity between Christianity and Roman Catholics." That's also a way you can read it, and that's the way I think that you have to read it. "Indeed, this disparity was the crux of the Protestantism which Pope Paul III commissioned the Society of Jesus to extirpate." That's why he called into living the Society of Jesus, exactly. Now, the author continues to say that biblical faith regards the Bible alone, sola scriptura, apart from any other source, to be a sufficient and infallible rule of life in the Bible's own words, as we can read in 2 Timothy 3, verse 16 and 17, quote, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly throughly furnished unto all good works. End quote. Roman Catholic faith, on the other hand, while agreeing that the Bible is God-breathed, considers the scripture neither infallible nor sufficient in itself as a rule of life, unless so interpreted by the magisterium, which is the authority of the Church, the teaching authority of the Church, and so pronounced by the infallible Pope. I'm going to give you a few quotations here that will support what Trapasorsi says here. For example, when we look up the Catholic Encyclopedia, Volume 12, page 496, it reads, "The supremacy of the Bible as source of faith is unhistorical, illogical, fatal to the virtue of faith, and destructive of unity. It is unhistorical." Unquote. And there's another quote I want to read to you that comes from the Roman Catholic Confessions for Protestants, Oath, Article 11. "We confess that the Pope has power of changing Scripture and of adding to it and taking from it according to his will." Unquote. Now, this Roman Catholic Confessions for Protestants oath is something that I will address in one of my next videos, because it is something that I've learned when I listened very closely and intensely to what's that guy called? Ian Paisley, and his reading on the Jesuits, where I have a video on. And he mentioned these Roman Catholic Confessions for Protestants oath, and I looked that up, and all these 23 points we will go through in another video, and I can tell you it is very interesting, and you will not, you don't want to miss that, I'm quite sure. But okay, the author continues, "At Paul III's Council of Trent between 1545 and 1563, which we have learned was closely supervised over its 18 years of existence by the Jesuits, it was even inaugurated by the Jesuits, it was decreed that the magisterium, quote, receives and venerates with a feeling of piety and reverence all the books of the Old and New Testaments, also the traditions, whether they relate to faith or morals, as having been dictated either orally by Christ or by the Holy Ghost, and preserved in the Catholic Church in unbroken succession," unquote. Over the centuries, Roman Catholic faith in Scripture, as modified by tradition, as pronounced by the magisterium and Pope, has bound millions of consciences to 1,000 doctrines not found in Scripture, and either unknown or rejected by the apostles and early Christian fathers. The 1776 seal agrees with Roman Catholic teaching as much as it disagrees with the Bible. Whereas the caption, quote, "Rebellion to tyrants is obedience to God," is found nowhere in Scripture, it is the cornerstone of Bellarminian liberation theology. And therefore, I ask you, look up who Bellarmine was, Cardinal Bellarmine, one of the most venerated Jesuits in their history. "The Bible never condones rebellion, not even rebellion to those tyrants under whom God's own people, the Israelites, were obliged to suffer continuously. When Scripture mentions rebellion, it is almost always referring to the disobedience of the Israelites toward their God, Yahweh. The 17th chapter of Proverbs teaches that, quote, the evil man seeks rebellion." And we can read the whole quote here. "An evil man seeketh only rebellion. Therefore a cruel messenger shall be sent against him," as the complete quote from 1 Samuel from Proverbs is reading. And 1 Samuel 15:23 admonishes that rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. The God of Scripture cannot be obeyed by evil doing and witchcraft. He will not be honored in the breach. However, sacred tradition authorizes anything in the service of Rome. Cum finis est licitus, etiam media sunt licita, meaning the end justifies the means. Sacred tradition authorizes anything in the service of Rome. The end justifies the means. Cum finis est licitus, etiam media sunt licita. Depicting rebellion as a salvational act, the 1776 seal further harmonizes with the Magisterium on how the sinful soul of man is saved from eternal punishment. The Magisterium concurs with the Bible that salvation is the free gift of God's grace, but adds the non-scriptural teaching that salvation can be lost if good works are not performed through the quote-unquote sacred channels of baptism, confession, and the Mass. Scripture, and more specifically Ephesians 2 verses 8 through 10, says that Jesus Christ does not share his saviorhood with anyone or anything. Quote, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." Unquote. Yet the Magisterium says that Christ is no savior without the sinner's cooperation with the church and its traditions. In fact, Scripture's recount of the Exodus shows the departure from Egypt not to be a rebellion at all. When called by Yahweh to represent Israel before Pharaoh, Moses pled himself incapable, uninformed, unauthorized, ineloquent, unadapted, unproven, and uncredentialed, hardly the audacious mindset of a great rebel leader. Now, all these points Tapper Saucy sums up here are to be found in the Bible. Moses pled himself incapable, as we can read in Exodus 3:11. And it reads, "And Moses said unto God, Who am I, that I should go unto Pharaoh, and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt?" He was uninformed, as we read in Exodus 3:13. Quote, "And Moses said unto God, Behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, The God of your fathers has sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, What is his name? What shall I say unto them?" He was not only uninformed, as we just read, but also unauthorized. He quotes in Exodus 4, verse 1, quote, "When Moses answered and said, But behold, they will not believe me, nor hearken unto my voice, for they will say, The Lord hath not appeared unto thee." He was ineloquent, as he states himself in Exodus 4, verse 10. "And Moses said unto the Lord, O my Lord, I am not eloquent, neither hitherto, nor since thou hast spoken of unto thy servant, but I am slow of speech and of a slow tongue." He was unadapted, as we can read in Exodus 4:13. Quote, "And he said, O my Lord, send, I pray thee, by the hand of him who thou wilt send." He was even unproven, as we can read in Exodus 5:23. Quote, "For since I came to Pharaoh to speak in thy name, he hath done evil to this people, neither hast thou delivered thy people at all." And uncredentialed, as we can read in Exodus 6, verse 12, "And Moses spake before the Lord, saying, Behold, the children of Israel have not hearkened unto me. How then shall Pharaoh hear me, who am of uncircumcised lips?" So, the Scripture's account of Exodus shows the departure from Egypt not to be a rebellion. We see what Moses was kind of a person. He pled himself incapable, uninformed, unauthorized, ineloquent, unadapted, unproven, uncredentialed. I think, really, what Tapper Saucy's point was going to make, this is hardly what an audacious mindset for a great rebel leader should be. So what Moses led was no rebellion, but a sociological deliverance for which Yahweh alone claimed responsibility. Quote, "Come now, therefore, and I will send you to Pharaoh, so that you can bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And I will stretch out my hand and smite Egypt with all my wonders which I will do in the midst thereof. And after that he will let you go." Unquote. This comes from Exodus 3, verse 10 and 20. If Adams, Franklin, and Jefferson wished the 1776 seal to express the true teaching of Scripture, they might have written, quote, Yahweh removes tyrants for his faithful. Meaning that if the founding of the United States of America in 1776 really would have been an act of Protestantism, of biblical founding that nation, it shouldn't read rebellion to tyrants is obedience to God, but it better could have read Yahweh removes tyrants for his faithful. Man is not made for rebellion. Man is there to obey God in the first place. Anyway, the author continues, but even with the biblically correct motto, the seal fails the biblical standard. For it is, after all, a seal, authority represented by a graven image. And what does the Bible teach about graven images? We are just going to learn about that. Although the use of seals and images is one of the Roman Catholicism's proudest sacred traditions, Scripture prohibits it. The only Israelite shown to rule with a seal is King Ahab, who, quote, did evil in the sight of the Lord above all that were before him, as we can read in 1 Kings 16, verse 30. Ahab's seal, apparently appropriated from ancient pagan tradition, was employed by his wife, the quintessentially wicked Jezebel, to commit fraud and murder, as we can read in 1 Kings 21, 8 through 16. And I'm going to read that here because this is a part that you really should understand before we go any further in this book. So from 1 Kings 8 through 16, it reads, so she wrote letters in Ahab's name and sealed them with his seal, and sent the letters unto the elders and to the nobles that were in his city, dwelling with Naboth. And she wrote in the letter, saying, proclaim a fast, and set Naboth on high among the people. And set two men, sons of Belial, before him to bear witness against him, saying, thou didst blaspheme God and the king, and then carry out and stone him, that he may die. And the men of his city, even the elders and the nobles, who were the inhabitants in his city, did as Jezebel had sent unto them, and as it was written in the letters which she had sent unto them. They proclaimed the fast, and set Naboth on high among the people. And there came in two men, children of Belial, and sat before him. And the men of Belial witnessed against him, even against Naboth, in the presence of the people, saying, Naboth did blaspheme God and the king. Then they carried him forth out of the city, and stoned him with stones, that he died. Then they sent to Jezebel, saying, Naboth is stoned, and is dead. And it came to pass, when Jezebel heard that Naboth was stoned, and was dead, that Jezebel said to Ahab, arise, take possession of the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite, which he refused to give thee for money, for Naboth is not alive, but dead. And it came to pass, when Ahab heard that Naboth was dead, that Ahab rose up to go down to the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite to take possession of it. Quite an example for misusing of a seal, isn't it? Now, Scripture warns of an unlimited potential for evil inherent in graven image seals. The apostles of Christ understood this principle well. They saw the Pharisees demand Jesus show them a token of his authority, and what Jesus showed them was not an image of but Scripture, the book of Jonah, as we can read in Matthew 12:39 and first following. Quote, but he answered and said unto them, an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given to it but the sign of the prophet Jonas. For as Jonas was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh shall rise in judgment with this generation, and shall condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonas, and behold, a greater than Jonas is here. Unquote. Now Paul the apostle had no seal except the people he'd evangelized, as we can read in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 2. Quote, if I be not an apostle unto others, yet doubtless I am to you. "For the seal of mine apostleship are ye in the Lord." Unquote. Indeed, the seal of the body of Christ is represented in Scripture not by mitre and crossed key of the Holy See, or the doves, flames, Bibles, bare crosses, and sunbursts of the Protestant denominations, but by Scripture alone, as we can read in 2 Timothy 2, verse 19. Quote, "Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his. And let every one that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity." Unquote. The early Christian leaders whose faith is historically regarded as the best informed of any generations, well, of course, because they were so close to the time of Christ's living, they had seen the real truth, they had even seen the real Messiah. The early Christian leaders whose faith is historically regarded as the best informed of any generations rigorously opposed the making of images or likeness of any kind. Scripture had taught them well that Yahweh's people always suffered terrible calamity whenever they violated the commandment not to identify themselves or their gods with, quote-unquote, any graven images or any likeness of anything, as we can read in Exodus 20, verse 4. Edwin Bevan's Holy Images, An Inquiry into Idolatry and Image Worship in Ancient Paganism and in Christianity, cites three important early churchmen who forbade images. The first is Clement of Alexandria, and he taught that images were, quote-unquote, not true, and were forbidden by Yahweh, quote, "in order that we might not direct our attention to sensible objects, but might proceed to the intelligible, unquote. The second was Origen. An Origen held that images, quote, "drag the soul down instead of directing the mind to a divine invisible reality," unquote. And third we have Tertullian, who instructed the servants of God to avoid every form of imagery, even secular art. Indeed, as Bevan points out, Christians of the 1st and 2nd centuries placed visual artists in a class with harlots, drunkards, brothel keepers, and actors. Now, what does that do in our day-to-day we live in? Huh? Christians of the 1st and 2nd centuries placed visual artists in a class with harlots, drunkards, brothel keepers, and actors. Beware of anything and everything coming out of so-called Hollywood. The author continues, but for thousands of years Mediterranean cultures had been receiving their religious and political information from myths narrated by visual art. Paulinus, Bishop of Nola, said of his congregations, quote, "they are not devoid of religion, but not able to read," unquote. This was Paulinus' excuse for beseeching the Bishop of Rome to permit him to teach with graven images. Paulinus had forgotten, or perhaps had never learned, that the basis of the Gospel of Christ was above all literary. Else why had its author prohibited graphic likeness? Knowing this, the apostles devoted a large part of the evangelical process to spreading literacy. Blessed is he who reads, as we read, as we read in Revelation 1, verse 3, quote, "Blessed is he that readeth, and he that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand," unquote. To keep the people from reading, as the papacy did through all the dark ages, which were dark not only because people didn't have the gospel, didn't have the Bible, but also because they had no knowledge, because they had no education, they had no literacy, they couldn't read books. That's why you had oral traditions. You know, the people in the land, they gave all their history, family history and history of what happened and everything, they gave that orally because they could not read and they could not write. And that is why in the Bible, writing reading literacy is so much held up, because you have to read to understand the Word of God, because the Word of God is written in the King James 1611 Bible. So when you can't read, you cannot communicate with God. But then you have to rely on people, most of the times priests, and they teach not the true Word of God, but they teach the teachings of man, as we know by the papacy. But okay, the author continues, even so, the Apostle Peter foresaw the time of Paulinus, Bishop of Nola, a time when, quote, false teachers among you shall bring in damnable heresies and denying the Lord, as we can read in 2 Peter 2, verse 1. What more damnable heresy could there be than depicting a God who condemns images with an image? What more damnable heresy could there be than depicting a God who condemns images with an image? Think about that. Could such a God even be depictable by an image? Wouldn't an image purporting to be him have to be in reality, by sheer force of logic, the image of another God? And what did God say about that? There are no other gods beside him, right? The Apostle Paul, aware of the compelling nature of images and their definitive incapacity to teach Jesus and the gospel, warned the Corinthians how easily a false teacher could lead them to, quote, another Jesus, another gospel, as we can read in 2 Corinthians 11, verse 4. The time was very close, Paul knew, when Christians, quote, will not endure sound doctrine, but will heap to themselves teachers who will switch them from the truth to myths, as we can confirm by reading 2 Timothy 4, verse 3 and 4. And what are graven images but the very grammar of myth? You know, letters have grammar when you write them. Symbols have that too. And all these images are the very grammar of the myths and of the symbols. What are graven images but the very grammar of myths? The switch began noticeably happening in the 3rd century, when teachers like Paulinus of Nola began instructing from pictures, for which Paulinus was canonized by the Roman Catholic Church, by the way. Of course, he used images to teach so-called the Word, or what he called the Word. That is contrary to Scripture, therefore the Roman Catholic Church, of course, has to make him a saint. He was canonized. With Constantine, a century later, as we've seen, a powerful new, quote-unquote, Christian visual language developed. Old mythic icons were renamed to fit Bible stories, and an iconic Christianity was spread through pagan images processed by missionary adaptation. Now, go back to the second chapter of the book to understand what missionary adaptation means. Okay? What the new converts were not taught is that Scripture categorically rejects such attempts to iconize its contents, and that therefore, again by sheer force of logic, the likeness upon whom they reverently gazed were no more than the gods and goddesses originally pictured, other gods of other gospels. Archaeology traces these gods and their gospels back to the very earliest Babylonian cathedrals. Now, for a better understanding of this, I advise you to read Alexander Hislop's The Two Babylons, or you can also follow my reading of the Babylon Mystery Religion that I do on Juggler 66 channel, which is actually kind of a summary of Hislop's work. Hislop's work is three or four kind as big as Babylon Mystery Religion, but when you understand Babylon Mystery Religion, you already have a very good grasp of how the archaeology traces these gods and gospels back to the Babylonian cathedrals, and where the connection between Babylon from then and Rome, Babylon from today, is. Okay? It was in these cathedrals, erected nearly 4,000 years before the Christian era, that the Roman Catholic sacred iconographic tradition was born. We We shall explore this subject in some detail in the forthcoming chapter. So, I'm already giving you a teaser to keep listening to chapter 21 at least when I'm done with chapter 20. The author continues on the page 208. Congress refused to adapt the 1776 seal. We may never know why. There is no record of any debate, only the notation that the seal was ordered to lay, quote-unquote, on the table. 5 years later, in the summer of 1781, a fleet of 25 French war vessels arrived at Chesapeake Bay, with more than 20,000 soldiers accompanied by 90 Roman Catholic chaplains and God only knows how many secularized Jesuits. Secularized Jesuits, the result of Lorenzo Ricci's planned, quote-unquote, abolishing of the Jesuit order. So the wolves now not only wear sheep's clothing, but any form of disguise one can imagine. They came in as lawyers, they came in as teachers, they came in as every profession they wanted to, and you could not tell whether Jesuits or not, because the Jesuits were officially forbidden. They had perfectly hidden behind the secular garments they hid behind. A month later, the British army surrendered to General Washington at Yorktown. The legend-spinning Visible War was over at last. Now, this is a very important sentence. The legend-spinning Visible War was over at last. The Jesuit theater, like all the wars since the Jesuits' rule, they are all theater, just played in front of us. The Visible War was over. In June 1782, Benjamin Franklin and John Adams were meeting in Paris to perfect a treaty with envoys of the newly elected British Prime Minister, Robert Petty. Now, we recall Robert Petty, Lord Shelburne, the ubiquitous Jesuit of Berkeley Square, who teamed with Lord Bute to conclude the French and Indian Wars in terms that had made the revolution inevitable. And who was the man behind that? Okay, you know the answer as well as I do. Franklin and Adams found themselves approaching the negotiating table without a national seal. Nothing they might do on behalf of the United States could be valid without a seal. This was the exigency that moved Congress to adopt on June 28 the seal designed by Charles Thompson and William Barton. The Great Seal is, quote-unquote, written in Kabbalah, that style of allegorical communication composed of seemingly unrelated symbols, numerals, and phrases. A piece in Le Charivari, number 18 in Paris, 1973, published, discussing certain symbolic motifs used by the enlightened French artist Nicolas Poussin, explains the practical advantage of Kabbalistic works. Quote, a single word suffices to illumine connections which the multitude cannot grasp. Such works are available to everyone, but their significance addresses itself to an elite. Above and beyond the masses, sender and receiver understand each other. Yeah, and the mess is left in the dark. End quote, by the way. Kabbalah goes beyond mere secret communication. Supposedly it thrusts the sender, quote, into direct contact with the living powers and forces of the universe, and through them with the eternal source of all manifestation, unquote, explains Henrietta Bernstein in her Kabbalah Primer. Quote, in other words, you make contact with God, unquote. With what God do you make contact when you use the Kabbalah? I am quite sure this is not the God of the Bible who forbids all these things. But, Henrietta Bernstein says, you make contact with God. To a Kabbalistic Gnostic Illuminatus whose special knowledge has liberated him from the clutch of matter and is speeding him toward the pure light of godliness, Kabbalah is, quote, the royal art, a closed body of knowledge sacred to the elect." Unquote. Since the Great Seal is written in the language of Kabbalah, it appears to be a veritable Gnostic constitution. In terms well known to initiates and God Almighty, it sets forth the origin, nature, purpose, and plan of American government. Of course, as Charles Thompson and Manly P. Hall have intimated, the initiates will never disclose to outsiders the meaning of the seal's elements. But God Almighty is not so aloof. He does not resist inquiries, nor is he a respecter of persons. Contrary to the Kabbalist's boasts of privileged access, Scripture promises more light to any mind that seeks it from God in person. Shining that light on commonly available histories of rulers and religions, anyone can trace the seal's elements back to their ancient origins, and in the end knows as much as, if not more than, the Gnostics. This is what we are going to be busy with the next part in this chapter. On the front or obverse side of the seal, we find an eagle clutching an olive branch and 13 arrows with a banner in his beak inscribed with the motto "E pluribus unum," that stands for "of many one." The earliest images of sacred eagles have been found in that region of present-day Iraq, once known as Babylon. The eagle was identified with Babylonian sky god Anu. When Anu entered sacred Roman iconography as Jupiter, the eagle was still his mascot. For the more than 2,000 years since the death of Rome's first emperor, Julius Caesar, and we are going to back to going a little bit more deep into Julius Caesar later on in this chapter. But you have to understand, Julius Caesar was the first Roman emperor who also bare the title Pontifex Maximus, which is the official title of the Pope today. For the more than 2,000 years since the death of Rome's first emperor, Julius Caesar, Jupiter's eagle has signified Rome's imperial power. Imperial meaning the right of the Caesars to make laws and enforce them. In many a church, Roman Catholic and Protestant alike, the Bible from which lessons are publicly read rests on a hardwood lectern carved in the shape of a magnificent eagle. Yet, in the pages of this very Bible, God forbids carved images of eagles. We can read that in Leviticus 11, verse 13. What then does the eagle signify, if not a power indifferent to Scripture? The brilliant cloud hovering over the eagle's head and the great seal is the Aegis. The Aegis is a goatskin, and we have already examined how Scripture equates the goat with worldly power and separation from God. You know, we have the sheep on the right and the goats to the left of God in heaven. Yeah? When Jupiter was a baby, he was nursed by a she-goat named Amalthea. The priestly artists often portrayed the adult Jupiter as a satyr, having a man's body with the horns, hair, and legs of a goat. When Amalthea died, Jupiter made the Aegis out of her hide. The Aegis of the Great Seal glorifies 13 five-pointed stars, or pentagrams. Each pentagram represents an original state. In Gnostic symbology, the pentagram is identified with Jupiter's wife, Venus. There is a natural reason for this. A dedicated observer from a fixed location over an 8-year period will discern that the planet Venus travels a unique celestial pathway that exactly describes a pentagram. Carl Jungmann, in Dictionary of Symbols, has written, quote, "As the orbit of Venus is closer to the Sun than the Earth's position, she is never seen more than 48 degrees from the Sun. During a period of 247 days, Venus is visible as the evening star, that is, within 48 degrees or less of the Sun after the Sun has set. Then Venus comes too close to the Sun for us to see her. She remains invisible for 14 days, then reappears as the morning star, or eastern star, immediately before the sun rises in the east. For 245 days, we can see Venus each morning at dawn before she again disappears into the sun's light by getting too close to the sun. Venus is now invisible for 78 days. On the 79th evening, she appears again in the west immediately after the setting sun. How she is in the evening star once more. If one knows the ecliptic, that is, the great circle of the celestial sphere, that is the apparent path of the sun among the stars, and can pinpoint the present position of the planets in relation to the constellation of fixed stars in the zodiac, one can mark the exact place in the 360 degrees of the zodiac where the morning star first appears shortly before the sunrise after a period of invisibility. If we do this, wait for the morning star to appear again 584 days later, the synodic orbital time of Venus, and mark its position in the zodiac, and then repeat this process until we have five positions of Venus as the morning star, we will find that exactly 8 years plus 1 day have passed. If we then draw a line from the first point marked to the second point marked, then to the third, and so on, we end up with a pentagram. Only Venus possesses the five-pointed star sign. Not one of the innumerable stars above us can recreate this by its own orbit. And remind you what the pentagram stands for, right? Remember Isaiah 14? Satan, Lucifer's rebellion in heaven? I will exalt myself above the stars of God. I will sit in the congregation. I will be like the Most High. Five eyes, the pentagram. And here you got it in Kabbalistic meanings. And even if you didn't understand it, it's not that bad, you know, because all this Kabbalistic is unbiblical. It is not for us real Bible-believing Christians to know or to fully understand. After all, don't forget, God is still in control. Whatever signs they use, you know. Anyway, on the bottom of page 211, the author continues, Charles Thomson, the great seals co-designer, led a group of dedicated observers of Venus. The first coordinated scientific experiment of the American Philosophical Society, the Club Thomson, founded for politically radical young professionals, focused on Venus's celestial pathway. On the evening of June 3, 1769, with colleagues stationed at three sites in Pennsylvania and Delaware, Thomson and five others watched from the public observatory on State House Square in Philadelphia an eclipse caused by, quote, the transit of Venus across the sun, unquote. The goddess Venus, as we've seen, was observed by missionary adaptation into the Roman Catholic sacred tradition as the Virgin Mary. The adepters even ascribed to Mary the Venusian epithet Queen of Heaven, a title never ascribed to Mary in the Bible. Queen of Heaven in Scripture names only one personage, and that is Ishtar, the Babylonian Venus, also known as Semiramis. Most faithful Catholics, historically insulated from Scripture by the Magisterium and the Inquisition, have not known this. Jeremiah 44 explains how the Israelites violated their covenant with Yahweh by praising the Queen of Heaven, and in turn lost their dignity, property, freedom, everything to the Babylonians. Scripture teaches also that the Babylonian interests have much to gain from inducing souls to praise the Queen of Heaven, and as we shall later see, their gain is divinely approved. The term Queen of Heaven appears nowhere else in the Old and in the New Testament, but in the book of Jeremiah. And exactly five times in the book of Jeremiah. Now, I have to make a little comment here, because the author writes in Jeremiah 44. But when you open up Jeremiah 44, you will see that there Queen of Heaven only appears four times. So, it is actually quite correct that in the book of Jeremiah, Queen of Heaven appears five times, but then you have to go to Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 18. There it appears for the first time. And then it appears in 44. And I'm just going to give you the links. You can look that up for yourself. I don't read a whole Jeremiah book here. But the first mention of the Queen of Heaven is in Jeremiah 7, verse 18. Then you have it in Jeremiah 44, 17, 44, 18, 19, and 25. So I'm going to read anything what the author means about the significance of five mentions in one chapter of the book, but that is for the book of Jeremiah, that is not true. Now make up your own mind about that and what you want to learn about the Queen of Heaven. Also, Mary, Astarte, Astaroth, Cybele, Venus, whatever pagan name given to Semiramis, the original pagan goddess from Babylon, from whom all other names derive. Watch my videos on Babylon mystery religion in the playlist with the same name when you want to get a more idea about this Queen of Heaven. But now Tapasorsi really makes a point about the Queen of Heaven being mentioned in Jeremiah 44 five times, which is not correct, and you can look that up for yourselves. Did Jeremiah know that Venus' celestial trail delineated 5 points, the author continues? And did the other 35 writers of the Bible's 66 books know as well? Did all these men who wrote in different languages over a period of more than 1,000 years conspire not to mention Queen of Heaven in order to preserve Jeremiah's 5 mentions, so that the link between A, the Queen of Heaven, B, the 5-pointed path of Venus, and C, the curse resulting from praising her, would stand as a divine lesson for the rest of eternity? Or did it just happen that way by accident? Or, as the Bible teaches, were Jeremiah and his co-authors inspired by the author of all creation to say, and not say, things for reasons beyond their individual understanding? The great seal's eagle holds a banner in its beak inscribed E Pluribus Unum. This phrase, which appears on American coinage as well, is popularly understood to signify the melting of many people into one nation. Quote, of many one, unquote. Or to identify the coin as one of many identical coins. The Gnostic understanding of this phrase, however, borders on the psychedelic. According to Manly P. Hall, E Pluribus Unum refers to the ancient Bacchic rites, which he says was, quote-unquote, a forerunner to Freemasonry. Mysterious and fantastic, the Bacchic rites are built upon the following storyline. Listen close. In a time before the creation of mankind, the 12 Titans caused Bacchus, Jupiter's beautiful son, to become fascinated by his own image in a mirror. Enthralled by himself, Bacchus is seized by the Titans. They kill him, tear him to pieces, boil the pieces in water, and afterwards roast and eat them. This grieves all his loved ones, hence his name from Bacca, to weep. Now remember, weeping for Tammuz, these deities are all the same. Weeping for Tammuz you can read in the New Testament, when the women on the temple were there. Hence his name from Bacca, to weep or lament. The strewn body parts of Bacchus become the 4 elements of matter. One of Bacchus' sister, the virgin Minerva, rescues his sacred heart from the 4 elements and places it before Jupiter in heaven. From heaven, Jupiter hurls thunderbolts at his son's murderers and reduces the Titans to ashes. The rains further reduce the ashes, mingling with the 4 elements, to slime. From this evil slime, Jupiter forms mankind, a quote-unquote titanic embodiment, from which the Bacchic idea or rational soul must be released. The Bacchic idea is released by evil slime's sexual energy, especially when facilitated by alcoholic drink. Hence, Bacchus is associated with grapevines, wild dancing, phallic symbols, and fornication. You know, Bacchus is the god of wine, right? When death and sex have rescued the rational soul from the four slimy corners of the earth, a transfigured, eternal Bacchus is resurrected as the flaming sun. He is a pluribus unum, one from many, a resurrection symbolized by the pentagram, the one rising out of the four to make five. This, says Manly P. Hall, is the magical formula of man. Quote, the human soul rising from the bondage of the animal nature. The pentagram is the true light, the star of the morning, marking the location of five mysterious centers of force, the awakening of which the supreme secret of white magic. Unquote. Now, white magic, black magic, all magic is the same. There is no difference between white and black magic. And all is forbidden by the Lord and an abomination to him. With a pluribus unum flowing from his beak, Jupiter's eagle preaches the Bacchic gospel. It is a gospel of salvation that antedates that of Jesus Christ by many, many centuries. The Bacchic gospel was preached and played out in the pagan cults. A holy virgin would ritually rescue the son of God's sacred heart from the slime of humanity imprisoning the son's soul. Each cult initiate, a fractional part of the son's soul, supposedly gained increasing amounts of knowledge from mind-altering substances and sexual ecstasy administered for money, of course, by the temple priest and priestesses. Did you get that? Each cult initiate, a fractional part of the sun's soul, supposedly gained increasing amounts of knowledge. Gaining knowledge from mind-altering substances and sexual ecstasy administered for money. Why do you think the woman is called a whore in Revelation 17? Rome is such a sex cult. Because they even think that through sex they get knowledge. Okay, continuing. The initiate looked forward to being released from his slimy humanity by ever-increasing knowledge. He yearned to be reunited ultimately with the Sacred Heart in heaven, resurrected and transfigured for all eternity. I mean, they really have some strange ideas about eternal life, don't you think? When you compare that to the Bible and what is promised to us. This salvational plan, the author continues, or some variation of it, can be found at the core of all the secret or mystery religions, cults of empire. It persists from the earliest Babylonian prototype right on down through the Great Seal. It has succeeded not because it calls for repentance from sin, but because it makes sin an asset in a process of self-deification. And if we are God, that is self-deification, we do not need a Messiah to save us. Isn't that the whole preaching of the New Age? Isn't that the whole preaching of Satanism, of Luciferianism? When we are gods, we do not need a God to save us, right? That's what it's all about, self-deification. The Bacchic gospel serves an economy of sin management, in which sins are forgiven upon the payment of money or performance of some act of contrition valuable to society. It is about people control, because it prospers on the addictive nature of fornication and mind-altering substances. It naturally facilitates sex and booze and drugs and all their destructive fallout in order to have a context in which to make itself useful. Unlike the Christian gospel, which conditions forgiveness of sins upon repentance, quote, and if he repents, forgive him, as we can read in Luke 17, verse 3, the Bacchic gospel forgives upon the tendering of appropriate sacrifices to the priest of the appropriate deity. The congeniality of this gospel to secular government and Roman Catholicism speaks for itself. the congeniality of this gospel to secular government and Roman Catholicism speaks for itself. Rome is more than just a church. It's most and for all a political entity. The congeniality of this gospel to secular government and Roman Catholicism speaks for itself. A powerful sentence that F. Tapasosi wrote here in this book. The reverse side of the Great Seal contains four elements. First, the motto Annuit Coeptis. Second, a 13-coursed topless pyramid with MDCCLXXVI engraved in the foundation. Third, a disembodied eye forming the pyramid's capstone. And fourth, the motto Novus Ordo Seclorum. These elements define exactly the quote-unquote divine providence upon whose protection the signers of the Declaration of Independence firmly relied. The land of the pyramid, Egypt, is where Caesarian Rome was inaugurated. By Caesarian, I mean the empire whose head commands not only affairs of state, but those of religion as well. Combination of church and state. What does the Bible say about that? It's one thing. What does the Roman Catholic Church teach about that? That's another thing. By Caesarian, I mean, the emperor says, the empire whose head commands not only affairs of state, but those of religion as well. Caesarian Rome officially began in Alexandria, Egypt, at the Temple of Jupiter on the winter solstice, December 25th. Oh, what an interesting date, eh? In the year 48 before Christ, when a 52-year-old priest of Jupiter was declared to be Jupiter's incarnation, thus, quote-unquote, son of God. His name was Caius of the family of Marius, Caius Mariae. After deification, and occasionally before, Caius Mariae was referred to as Caesar, a cabalism formed by the letter C, for Caius, attached to Azar, the Etruscan word for God. The god Caius. Suetonius, the first century biographer of the Caesars, suggested that the title was formed from prefixing Azar with the numeral C, meaning hundred, God of the hundred, or hundreds. Now, I'm going to read this little paragraph again because it is so fascinating. After deification, and occasionally before, Caius Mariae was referred to as Caesar, a cabalism formed by the letter C for Caius, attached to Azar, the Etruscan word for God. The god Caius. And Suetonius, the first century biographer of the Caesar, suggested that the title was formed from prefixing Azar with the numeral C, meaning hundred, god of the hundred, or hundreds. According to Scottish theologian Alexander Hislop, author of The Two Babylons, Caesar consented to deification in order to inherit the huge kingdom of Pergamum, consisting of most of Asia Minor, present-day Turkey that is. Pergamum was bequeathed to the Roman people in 133 BC by its king, Attalus III. But there was a catch. The people of Rome had to regard their leader as God. The Pergaminian kings had begun ruling as God when the title of Pontifex Maximus fled the fall of Babylon in 539 BC. In that eventful year, Persian invaders assassinated the Babylonian king Belshazzar. Just moments prior, Belshazzar had seen his assassination prophesied by the famous handwriting on the wall, Mene, mene, tekel, upharsin, as we can read in Daniel chapter 9, Daniel chapter 5 in the King James Version. Mene, mene, tekel, upharsin, the numberer is numbered. Ruling as God by divine appointment, Belshazzar had profaned the sacred vessels of the Israelite temple. This was the unpardonable sin of blasphemy, for which God sent the Persians to destroy him. So you see, people don't have to rise up against an unlawful leader. God will send some way to do that, as he did here in Daniel 5, that you can read with Mene Mene Tekel Upharsin, the number is numbered. God took it into his own hands to get rid of this ungodly ruler in time. Not we. We should in peace hold to God and not take weapons again unrighteous rulers. God will judge them. That's not our job to do. Now Belshazzar's priests were evidently spared. Rather than submit to the Persian conquerors, they furtively gathered together all their portable treasures, entitlements, codes, inscriptions, astrology, sacred formula and insignia, and fled with them northwesterly to Pergamum. Since the rulers of Pergamum were already practicing Babylonian religion, they were honored to receive the fugitive Babylonian college and their great endowment. Pergamum, the new residence of Pontifex Maximus, became a showplace for despotism. The neighboring Greeks reflected its sudden transformation with the myth of Midas, the king whose touch turned everything to gold. Babylonian rule graced Pergamum with the world's greatest medical complex, the Asclepion, dedicated to the god of pharmacological healing, Asclepius. Pergamum became the most important humanist learning center, its library housing more than 200,000 scrolls. Mark Antony would later move these assets to Alexandria as a gift to Cleopatra. Many of them eventually found their way from Alexandria to the Medici Library in Florence, where we have Medici learning from. Learning against learning, and the Medici are also an old papal bloodline, so there are probably a lot of all these scrolls in the Vatican. When Attalus III died in 133 BC, he bequeathed all his kingdom's Babylonian grandeur to the Romans. But no Roman emperor was deemed fit to receive it because the Roman constitution had never suffered a man to be deified. The bequest lay unclaimed until 48 BC, when Caius Marius Caesar was declared God Almighty in the Serapion, Alexandria's temple of Jupiter. Deification entitled Caesar now to assume the title Pontifex Maximus. To indicate his infinitely holier status, he took the name Julius. The name was a claim of descent from Julius Ascanius, the legendary son of legendary Aeneas, Virgil's maritime hero, who sailed westward with a band of his Trojan fellow countrymen fleeing the sack of Troy by Greek marauders. Assisted by the whole heavenly network of mythic deities, Aeneas led his followers to sacrifice their individuality for a glorious collective existence that would one day be called Rome. This is a so very interesting sentence, I cannot go over it without commenting. Aeneas led his followers to sacrifice their individuality for a glorious collective existence that would one day be called Rome. Now look through our time that we are living in today. Isn't that exactly what the Roman Catholic Church teaches? We are all one, we are all equal, all people are created equal, as they say anyway. Yeah? No, we are not all equal. I am different than you are, and you are different than your neighbor is, and you are different than your father and your mother is. We are all individuals. But Aeneas led his followers to sacrifice their individuality. That is just the point. There you know where that comes from. And that is not the Bible. But that is Troy. That is Greek. That is Greek teaching. Balaminian, Thomas Aquinas and all the other so-called teachers of the Roman Catholic Church that teach that everybody is the same. You have to give up your individuality to fit in the big mass of where everything has a collective existence and individuality is wrong. That's the teaching of Rome. That's the teaching of Antichrist. And here you know where it comes from. Aenas led his followers to sacrifice their individuality for a glorious collective existence that would one day be called Rome. What is the last kingdom? Daniel prophesied in his prophecy of four kingdoms to King Nebuchadnezzar at Babylon in that time. First Babylon, second Medo-Persia, third Greece, and fourth Rome. There you have proof that we are still living in that Roman Empire. And by the actions, when you look around it today and see what the Antichrist, the Pope, is doing and saying in all his speeches and things where he is, you have to be dumb not to see that. Surely, when you follow reading this book, I hope that you finally will understand it. That you will finally get it. It is just like Tupper Saucy said when he was in this interview with Greg Szymanski, that while he was writing this book and reading these things and researching these things, he said, "Can you believe it? Can you believe it?" This is one of the points. Assisted by the whole heavenly network of mythic deities, Aenas led his followers to sacrifice their individuality for a glorious collective existence that would one day be called Rome. Aenas was considered the offspring of a union between a human being, Anchises, and Jupiter's wife, Venus. When Anchises boasted of his intercourse with the goddess, Jupiter struck him blind with a thunderbolt. The Aeneid, and I told you, remember, that I mentioned before that there is a book read out on YouTube of that historic work. If you want to read more about this fable of the Aeneid, then you can go to YouTube and listen to that audiobook. But you gotta be very patient. I tell you, it's a long one, and it's not easy to understand. But the Aeneid opens with Aeneas carrying blind old Anchises out of Troy on his shoulders. By taking the name of Aeneas' son Julius and claiming descent from him as well, Caesar was able to trace his lineage back to the Queen of Heaven. The divine lineage supposedly flowed through his mother, Maria, who was purported to have conceived him without losing her virginity. Maria also claimed to have remained a virgin even in childbirth by having her son delivered from the side in a surgical operation that still bears Caesar's name, still today. Ever wondered where the Caesar cut came from? When they deliver babies without going through the normal birth canal, but operatively, the C-section, as they call it. Did you understand that Caesar was able to track his lineage back to the Queen of Heaven, that he be of divine, conception? Yeah, isn't that what in the Bible is said about Jesus? Do you see how the devil counterfeits everything? Everything that is written in the Bible with Caesar and making him Pontifex Maximus and telling the fable, I call it fable, that through his mother Maria, who was purported to have conceived him without losing her virginity, she also claimed to have remained a virgin even in childbirth by having her son delivered from the side in a surgical operation that still bears Caesar's name. All of this quote-unquote fable and endless genealogy, which Paul taught the church not to heed, is foundational to American secular government. For it is Julius Ascanius, grandson of Venus and claimed ancestor of the original Caesar, who inspired Annuit Coeptis, the upper motto on the flip side of the Great Seal of the United States. The phrase, which the U.S. Department of State interprets to mean, quote, "God hath favored this undertaking," unquote, was spoken by young Julius Ascanius in the ninth book of Virgil's Aeneid. The scene is a battleground. But yeah, let's go back to this sentence that I just read. So the U.S. Department of State says Annuit Coeptis stands for "God hath favored this undertaking," right? And that was spoken by young Julius Ascanius in the ninth book of Virgil's Aeneid. What does Virgil's Aeneid, I ask you, have to do with anything with the God of the Bible, with the creator of the world? Nothing. Nothing. It is a deception, people. And if God hath favored this undertaking, it is not the God of the Bible, because that God was not spoken in any of the books of Virgil's Aeneid. Get that through your heads. Okay, the author continues. The scene is a battleground. The Trojans are outnumbered and fearful. Young Julius Ascanius takes a position in front of his shrinking countrymen. He looks up at an evil giant named Remulus, king of the Rutulus. Remulus mocks the Trojans for sending a boy to fight him. While the giant quakes with derisive laughter, Julius slips an arrow onto his bowstring and cries toward the heavens, quote, "Almighty Jupiter, favor this rebellious undertaking, audacibus ad nue coeptis. Each year I shall bring to thy temple gifts in my own hands and place a white bullock at thy altar." Unquote. Jupiter then hisses an arrow from the sky that strikes Remulus in the head with such force that it passes clean through his temples. The Trojans, quote, "raise a cheer and laugh aloud. Their hearts rise towards the stars," unquote. Apollo, from his throne of clouds, shouts the Gnostic credo, quote, "by striving so, men reach the stars, dear son of gods and sire of gods to come," unquote. A thrilling story. Does anybody see resemblance to David and Goliath? Well, we are going into that in the next paragraph. A thrilling story. And one that leaves no doubt as to the identity of the God who favored the undertaking of the United States. It was a pagan deity, the God of Julius Ascanius, and not the God of the Bible. Surely, if Congress had wanted to show that the new nation was underwritten by Yahweh, God of the Bible, it could have referred to the boy Down's giant story told in the Old Testament. Who doesn't know David and Goliath? Charles Thomson's biblical scholarship could easily have produced a motto based on Samuel 17, verse 47, where David says to Goliath, quote, "The Lord saves not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands," unquote. Reduced to an original language motto at least as comprehensible as Annuit Coeptis, the passage might have appeared in the seal as the Hebrew, and of course here standing a Hebrew word of two that I cannot read, or even in translation, quote, "the battle is the Lord's," unquote. But establishing a national government directly on biblical scripture was not the intent, I believe, for the founding fathers, Tapasosi says here. He believes that? No, of course not, because the hidden faith of the founding fathers was Romanism. in all its consequences. It was Luciferianism when you trace it back to the ground. There was never ever the intention to found a biblical country. Listen, the pilgrims who came into that country, who fled most and for all Germany from the old Europe, who fled Ireland, who fled England, and who fled Holland, I mean the Netherlands today, and all the other countries that made all the people out that came in the first centuries after the discovering of the continent of America over there, they knew why they flew from Europe. They knew that the Antichrist was the Pope. They knew that the Pope suppressed them through centuries. That's why it was called the Dark Ages. They went there in the best intentions ever. But the government that was formed over them in 1776, that was not of the same spirit. That is something that you have to understand. Though the people were Protestant, the government was not. And of course, the government had to be careful not to show its full intentions, who are satanical to the core from the beginning, because otherwise there would have been an uprising and the government would have probably been kicked out of the United States of America. They couldn't risk that, so they just took time and time and time. And because the country was more or less founded by Jesuits, a lot of Jesuits came into there and they took over not only the pulpit, but they took over the pulpit, very sure for that, and with that indoctrinated the Americans from the beginning of the 19th century or the middle of the 19th century with futurism, but they took over the whole education system. And when you take over the education system, what does that lead to? Well, as we read earlier in Rulers of Evil, how many what percentage was required in a university to have a history class in 1914? What was the percentage in 1939? What was the percentage in 1964? And what was the percentage in 1996? Go back and read them. That is how you take over a country, by education and by omitting through education history, omitting historic facts. That's how you do it. So the author continues, by establishing a national government directly on biblical scripture was not the intent, I believe, on the founding fathers. Far more useful to them and acceptable to the souls they knew would be populating America in good time were the fabulous vanities of Roman religion. These souls required the sacred icons of burgeoning humanity in uninhibited sexual energy, legends that inspired hot-blooded heroism and patriotism. Consent to images of this character presumed obedience to the omnipotent intelligence hovering inscrutably above the establishment of ancient, stone-heavy, well-ordered, pyramidic hierarchy. Less than 4 years after his deification, Julius Caesar was assassinated by an executive conspiracy. For another 4 years, civil war raged as two of the assassins, Brutus and Cassius, struggled for control against Caesar's immediate successor, a triumvirate comprised of Lepidus, Mark Antony, and Caesar's adopted son, his biological grandnephew, Caius Octavian Capias. The triumvirate defeated the assassins only to war against each other. Poets lamented that Rome, against whom no foreign enemy had ever prevailed, was being destroyed by the strength of her own sons. Now, what's the comparison to the United States of America? It is the enemy within that destroys your country, not the enemy from without, not ISIS, ISIL, or whatever, but the Roman Catholic Church that works from the inside like a cancer in your country. And not only in your country, in all countries. And I can sing a very loud song of that over here in Belgium, We are so Catholic you haven't even seen that here. Chapel on every 20 meters on the street corner. Get sick of it. Obligations of every kind dissolved, the author continues. Class fought against class. A fog of guilt and despair settled in. The poets yearned for escape beyond the world's borders to a place of innocence and peace, perhaps to a new order of things. Where have I heard that before? In his book about Rome's revolution from Republic to Babylonian autocracy, Oxford historian Ronald Syme writes, quote, "The darker the clouds, the more certain was the dawn of redemption. On several theories of cosmic economy, it was firmly believed that one world epoch was passing, another was coming into being. The lore of the Etruscans, the calculations of astrologers, and the speculations of philosophers might conspire with some plausibility and discover in the comet that appeared after Caesar's assassination the sign and herald of a new age. Vague aspirations and magical science were quickly adopted for purposes of propaganda by the rulers of the world. Already coins of the year 43 BC bear symbols of power, fertility, and the Golden Age." Unquote. The most influential and enduring celebration of Golden Age optimism was Virgil's prophetic-sounding Fourth Eclogue. This work was addressed to one of Virgil's chief benefactors, Caius Asinius Pollio, who was consul, roughly equivalent to the office of president today, when Caius Octavian, Antony, and Lepidus were reconciled in 40 BC by the Peace of Brindisi. Pollio, who represented Octavian at the Brindisi negotiations, introduced Virgil to Caius Maecenas, the media mogul of his day. He had risked his fortune supporting Julius Caesar's rise to absolute dictatorship, and he would risk no less to put Caesar's adopted son, Caius Octavian, in this very same place. He scouted and subsidized the most highly talented artists, sculptors, and poets to create a totally new kind of communication. Virgil gave him the most for his money. Virgil developed a new quote-unquote civic literature, whose pious rhetorical style gently guided public opinion toward accepting the rule of a deified Babylonian autocrat. In writing the Fourth Eclogue, Virgil borrowed heavily from the messianic verses of Isaiah, whose writings were freely accessible through the Jewish rabbis of Rome. Quote, "Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and call his name God with us," as we can read in Isaiah 7, verse 14. "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace," as we can read in Isaiah 9, verse 6. Of course they knew the Bible at that time. Rome was the usurper of Judea at that time. Rome was the ruler of Jerusalem at that time. They had access to the writings, and they knew the different roots. They knew the roots of paganism, and they knew the roots of God. That's why they mingled them. The author continues, 600 years after Isaiah, Virgil solemnly announced in the Fourth Eclogue that the Prince of Peace would be produced by the unrolling of a new world order, Novus Ordo Seclorum. Quote, "Now returns the golden age of Saturn. Now appears the Immaculate Virgin. Now descends from heaven a divine nativity. O chaste Lucina, goddess of maternity, speed the mother's pains, haste the glorious birth, and usher in the reign of thy Apollo. Thy consulship, O Pollio, shall lead this glorious advent, and the new world order, Novus Ordo Seclorum shall then begin to roll. Thenceforth, whatever vestige of original sin remains shall be swept away from earth forever, and the Son of God shall be the Prince of Peace." Unquote. And be sure, I was not talking about Jesus in this quote. The billionaire Maecenas exploited the fourth eclogue in the media as though it were a divine summons for Caesar's adopted son Octavian to take the throne and begin sweeping the world free of sin. A fabulous resume of Octavian was already going around about how a thunderbolt had blasted the city wall of his birth, of its birthplace, Velitrae, just prior to his birth. And how the priests interpreted this to be Jupiter's way of saying the future ruler of the world would arise from the spot. And about how the Senate, upon hearing this, had decreed that all male babies should be executed. And how Octavian was saved by his mother, who pilfered the stone tablet on which the decree was engraved. Octavian's mother was Atia, of the family of Marius, Atia Maria, a Vestal virgin, niece of Caius Maria, the man who would become Julius Caesar. When Octavian reached the age of 12, great-uncle Caius became his legal father through adoption. 3 years later, in Octavian's 15th year, his adoptive father was deified as Julius Caesar, Pontifex Maximus. That's when the propagandists of Maecenas got busy promoting the son's divine origins, about how the child was born on September 28, 63 BC, in humble circumstances. Now, do you see anything in this date, September 28? Isn't that interesting, as we know, that Jesus was also born probably in September? Because the sheep were still out in the meadows. Jesus wasn't born on the 25th of December. As if anything, he was conceived the 25th of December. But born, he was in September, as all biblical, true biblical scholars agree on. And there we see that also here, Satan has his counterfeit. The butler's pantry, the author continues, at his grandfather's mansion at Velitrae was the place that child was born. About how he had been conceived on December 25th by Apollo, who came in serpent form and impregnated the virgin Attia Maria as she lay sleeping on the floor of the Apollonian temple. About how, just prior to the child's advent, the virgin Maria had dreamed that her body was scattered to the stars and encompassed the universe. About how her husband, too, had dreamed that from within her shone the bright beams of the sun, which then, quote, rose from between her thighs, unquote. About how the toddler Octavian's head was often seen being licked by golden solar flames. The propaganda circulated the story of how the great astrologer Theognis, when told Octavian's birth sign, which is the Capricorn, rose and flung himself at the lad's feet. Theognis knew the astrological ruler of Capricorn was Saturn, whose second golden age was at hand. Saturn, the celestial mythical father god of Rome and father of Jupiter. Octavian, as the incarnation of Jupiter, would be ruled by Saturn, the most dictatorial house in the zodiac, terrible for his restriction, limitation, control, even to the excesses of fornication and cannibalizing of his own children. No wonder Theognis flung himself at Octavian's feet. In 28 BC, 12 years after the publication of the fourth eclogue, Octavian entered Rome triumphantly as the Prince of Peace. Like Julius had done, the new Pontifex Maximus received a new and holier name, Caesar Augustus. Quote, "Since sanctuaries and all places consecrated by the augurs are known as August, according to Suetonius," unquote, a little mentioning in the brackets here from the author. And like Julius, he was hailed as, quote unquote, son of God. Historian Alexander Del Mar describes the universal acceptance of the divine Octavian in these excerpts from his landmark exposition of Roman political deification, The Worship of Augustus Caesar, in 1899. Quote, in the firm establishment of the messianic religion and ritual, Augustus ascended the sacred throne of his martyred sire and was in turn addressed as the Son of God, Divi Filius, whilst Julius was worshipped as the Father. This claim and assumption appears in the literature of his age, was engraved upon his monuments and stamped upon his coins. It was universally admitted and accepted throughout the Roman Empire as valid and legitimate according to chronology, astrology, prophecy, and tradition. His actual worship as the Son of God was enjoined and enforced by the laws of the empire, accepted by the priesthood and practiced by the people. Both de jure and de facto, it constituted the fundamental article of the Roman imperial and ecclesiastical constitution. Unquote. Now, do you see here the resemblance between the kingdom of Satan and the kingdom of God? Speaking about the Son of God who just came a little bit earlier than Jesus himself came, the Bible prophesied real Son of God, of the only existing God, and not of these fake gods that we are talking about here when we are talking about Romans. Do you see the deception? Do you get it? As supreme pontiff of the Roman Empire, Augustus lawfully acquired and exercised authority over all cardinals, priests, curates, monks, nuns, flamens, augurs, vestal virgins, temples, altars, shrines, sanctuaries, and monasteries, and over all religious rites, ceremonies, festivals, holidays, dedications, canonizations, marriages, divorces, adoptions, benefices, wills, burying grounds, fairs, and other ecclesiastical subjects and matters. The common people wore little images of Augustus suspended from their necks. Great images and shrines of the same god were erected in the highways and resorted to for sanctuary. There were 1,000 such shrines in Rome alone. Augustus wore on his head a pontifical mitre surmounted by a Latin cross, an engraving of which, taken from a coin of the Colonia Julia Gemella, appears in Hardwini, the De Numis Antiquis, from 1689, plate 1. The images of Augustus upon the coins of his own mintage, or that of his vassals, are surrounded with the halo of light, which indicates divinity, and, I have to add, sun worship, of course. And on the reverse, sun worship, S-U-N, huh? And on the reverse of the coins are displayed the various emblems of religion, such as the mitre, the cross, crook, fishes, labarum, and the Buddhic or Bacchic or Dionysian monogram of PX, the Greek Chiro, coming from Cairo, site of the Great Pyramid. You see how it all works together, eh? The Augustan writers furnished materials showing that Augustus' incarnation was the issue of a divine father and mortal mother, and that the mother was a wife virgin, that the birth occurred in an obscure place, that it was foretold by prophecy or sacred oracle, that it was presaged or accompanied by prodigies of nature, that the divinity of the child was recognized by sages, that the Holy One exhibited extraordinary signs of precocity and wisdom, that his destruction was sought by the ruling power, that his miraculous touch was sufficient to cure deformity or disease, that he exhibited a profound humility, that his deification would bring peace on earth, and that he would finally ascend to heaven, there to join the Father. Isn't it fascinating how the devil copies everything that God puts out in the original first for us to see and to study through his wonderful world, the Bible? The author continues on the bottom of page 222 if you're reading alone. So universally were his divine origin and attributes conceded that many people, in dying, left their entire fortunes to his sacred personal fisc, in gratitude, as they themselves expressed it, for having been permitted to live during the incarnation and earthly sojourn of this Son of God. In the course of 20 years, he thus inherited no less than 35 million gold aurei, which is nearly amounting to $1 billion in 1996 values. In the course of 20 years, he inherited what we call today $1 billion 20 years ago. How much is that today? Probably a little bit more, eh? And anyway, 1996 values? Nah, worth nothing. Paper, fiat, currency, Federal Reserve, debt notes have absolutely no worth. But 35 million gold aurei, that is something you can do something with. Many potentates bequeathed him not only their private fortunes, but also their kingdoms and people in vassalage. The marble and bronze monuments to Augustus still extant contain nearly 100 sacred titles. Among them are Jupiter Optimus Maximus, Apollo, Janus, Quirinus, Dionysus, Mercurius, Volcanus, Neptunius, Liber Pater, Savos or Savior, and Jesus. At his death, Senator Numericus Atticus saw his spirit ascend to heaven. The ascension of Augustus is engraved upon the great cameo from the spoils of Constantinople, presented by Baldwin II to Louis IX, and now in the cabinet of France. A facsimile of it is published in Durie's History of Rome. And I will see when I make the video that I can get a picture of that in there. America's Great Seal, which still is the subject of American Graffiti of Chapter 20 of Rulers of Evil by Tupper Saucy. America's Great Seal, the author continues, with its obsessive fidelity to Caesarian Rome, cannot represent a nation more moral than the source of its scripture. The icons and mysterious Kabbalistic language of this seal introduce a preposterous Babylonian gospel, not biblical gospel. Taken seriously, and shouldn't a government solemn statement be taken seriously? The seal's gospel teaches that America's high spiritual purpose is to assist in the resurrection of the Son of God's mutilated parts from the evil slime of human flesh. It tells us that already the Holy Virgin has rescued the Son's sacred heart from the slime, e pluribus unum, one from many, and has placed it high in the vault of heaven, as her five-pointed celestial path describes for all to see. It calls for America to exert fervent sexual energy, so that the Son's many parts on earth might be united with unum in heaven. It promises that America will rise toward the pure light of sinlessness and godliness into eternal life as part of the solar body of the Sun, S-O-N, the S-U-N of God. It promises that America will rise toward the pure light of sinlessness and godliness. Isn't that what Luciferians teach? The pure light that is Lucifer? Into eternal life as part of the solar body of the sun of God. It signifies that this cosmic resurrective process is administered by a pyramidic hierarchy conceived in ancient Babylon, exported to Asia Minor, and bequeathed to Rome. At the top of the hierarchy sits an unseen chieftain, an unknown superior, a god of the seal who possesses universal intelligence and authority over every soul who confederates with or subscribes to the seal. The god of the seal wields the fasces to sweep the earth clean of the last traces of original sin. He is assisted by a new priestly order, a quote-unquote new world order, charged with destroying all individual identity deemed inconsistent with the resurrection to godliness. Uncooperative governments and dissident citizens alike are cut down by arts of war so frugal that the liquidation increases popular faith in the fasces. Because they function in a golden era of Saturn, the chief and his hierarchy can be depended upon to mimic Saturn's strictness, cruelty, licentiousness, even cannibalism, as the situation requires. To the charge that such is impossible in America, one comparison should be sufficient. No sooner was Augustus Caesar deified than he sacrificially murdered 300 senators in Perugia to atone for the assassination of his adoptive father, Julius. Likewise, no sooner was an American president inaugurated than he, as commander-in-chief of the armed forces, authorized the sacrificial murder of nearly 100 misguided Christians near Waco, Texas, to atone for what? A growing popular disenchantment with federal government? When we go and speak about Waco, let me make sure that you understand one thing very well. There's a 5-part, I think, documentary out there on YouTube that you can look up. It's called The Militarization of America. It is a video made by, another brother, Bob Treffs. And in part 3 or part 4, they go very, very deep into Waco. And everything that you have heard up to now from Waco, throw it overboard. Watch that video and you will understand what really happened in Waco, and you will really understand that that was a sacrifice. That was a blood sacrifice of innocent men, women and children at that time. And it was done under the rule of Bill Clinton. Do you remember Bill Clinton? Didn't he say in the beginning of this book, the worst thing that you can do is underestimate your adversary? Didn't he make Professor Quigley his mentor at Jesuit Georgetown University? Don't you think that Bill Clinton was absolutely aware of the Aeneid, of Virgil, of all this Roman history that I was just talking about here? Just doing the same thing that Augustus did in that time? By murdering 300 senators in Perugia? He just went over there to Waco to set an example, to say, you are not going against the government. This is so profound, people. This is so in your face. I thank Tupper Saucy really for writing this book. What a wonderful work. Now, I'm going to continue for a little moment. What the seal of the United States of America represents to anyone who takes it seriously is a ministry of sin. A speech by Jesuit political scientist Michael Novak, published in the January 28, 1989 issue of America, the weekly magazine of American Jesuits, sums it up eloquently enough. Now, before I go and read you that quote the Tupper Saucy put in here, I want to tell you a little bit about Michael Novak. Michael Novak. He is quoted here, and I'm going to read to you what Michael Novak read in the first chapter of the book The Global Vatican, that was written by Knight of Malta, a former ambassador to the Holy See between 2005 and 2008, Francis Rooney, which my wonderful brother in Christ, Tom Fress from Inquisition Update, read completely in 99 fantastic parts. You can watch these on the YouTube channel firstamendmentradio.net, where his complete reading of the book The Global Vatican is put in there. Now, this Michael Novak that I'm quoting now, in a minute, from Rulers of Evil, wrote in the first chapter of The Global Vatican, from Knight of Malta written book from Francis Rooney, quote, "By reputation, the United States is a Protestant country and Catholics were asserted to be unsuited for it. Yet, virtually every Catholic writer or thinker who visited America since 1607 has been excited by the country's extraordinary consonance with Catholic faith." Unquote. This is how the book The Global Vatican by Knight of Malta Francis Rooney opens up in the first chapter that deals most and for all with the Carols and the real founding fathers. And of course, by that you learn of the faith they had of the United States of America, the Carols that are never taught in your school. The first chapter of Global Vatican deals with that. And that same Michael Novak that opened that book in chapter 1 there, we can read of a quote here in Tapasorsi's book Rulers of Evil on page 224. The quote is the following. Sharpen your ears, people. Quote, "The framers wanted to build a, quote-unquote, novus ordo that would secure, quote, liberty and justice for all, unquote. The underlying principle of this new order is the fact of human sin. To build a republic designed for sinners, then, is the indispensable task. There is no use building a social system for saints. There are too few of them. And those there are impossible to live with. Any effective social system must therefore be designed for the only moral majority there is. Sinners." End quote. Now do you get it? America was founded for sinners, and not only America. Because he says, to build a republic designed for sinners then is an indispensable task. There is no use building a social system for saints. Who are the saints? Bible-believing Christians. And something that comes very well out in that interview that Tapasorsi gave on Greg Szymanski's or Greg Anthony's interview there. Look that up. Look that interview up. He says it for himself. You cannot put a Bible-believing Christian as president of the United States of America. How can he rule with the principles of the Bible all these evil people? It's impossible. You have to have evil people on the top to rule evil people. So you know that as long as you are ruled by evil people, you know that you are probably evil yourself. Or at least the majority of your population. Now look at the majority of your population, see if you belong to that, and see if you are evil or not. Are you one of the sinners that country was built for? Or are you a Bible-believing Christian who belongs to the kingdom of Christ, where there is no sin, because you repent of that sin, because you have a king, because you have a Lord up high, who died for you, who died for your sins, who shed his blood 2,000 years ago? Where do you belong to? I'm going to continue after repeating that quote from Michael Novak once again. The framers wanted to build a novus ordo that would secure liberty and justice for all. The underlying principle of this new order is the fact of human sin. To build a republic designed for sinners, then, is the indispensable task. There is no use building a social system for saints. There are too few of them, and those there are impossible to live with, from the standpoint of the sinner, of course. Any effective social system must therefore be designed for the only moral majority there is, sinners. Social systems are for sinners, because Bible-believing Christians do not need a social system. And why don't they do that? Why don't they need that? Well, read your Bible and you will understand. Whenever social security or all that stuff comes into your country, run! Run! If you can. The author continues. In the next chapter, we shall examine how faithfully the founding fathers reconstructed Babylonian Rome on the banks of the Potomac. That will be chapter 21, and that chapter 21 is called Jupiter's Earthly Abode. And I want to make you warm for that. As you probably remember, I already read in the last chapter what in this chapter will be talked about. Jupiter's Earthly Abode. Well, I'm going to take a little break from reading because I got other things to do. But when I come back in full charge reading chapter 21. Up to here, thank you very much for your attention. I hope you enjoyed it. At least as much as I did, I hope. Okay. In the meantime, don't forget to do your own studies, do your own research, study the Bible, study the New World Order, which is nothing else than the Old World Order restored. Come to Christ, come to Jesus, come to His Word. Until next time, God bless you all and bye-bye.